Sharon is our town historian and author. She's president of the Friends of the Joe Blaine House and is a volunteer coordinator at the Joe Blaine Farm Museum. She's also a member of our society board of directors. She's best known for her service as the children's librarian at the Bedford Library for 40 years. And during a long association with the library, which houses the Bedford flag, she was inspired to research and write her first book. And her second book came out more recently. With that, Sharon, you're on.
How good it is to be together. I have to tell you, I have an essential tremor, which is this. I'm not so scared that I'm about to fall over. I'm with friends. I'm not scared at all. Well, a little bit. But they used to be called benign essential tremors. And then it was discovered by medical science that they're not benign. They're a pain in the ass. So they just essential tremor, not benign essential tremor. So there you go. I have an announcement to make. Since you are all clearly not busy on Sunday afternoons, perhaps I could invite you to come to the Joe Blaine House annual meeting, which is held at the Common Room and the First Parish Church, which is across the street. We are going to be having a Native American storyteller telling stories. I think there's going to be one about a hummingbird. She really likes hummingbirds. But I hope you might think of coming, and I can tell you more about that.
What's the date?
Next Sunday, the 3rd.
2 o'clock.
2 to 4. Thank you. Did the Underground Railroad stop here? This is about slavery in Old Bedford. In the old burying ground, there's a shady part, a sunny part, and beyond that sunny part, in the shadow, there's an area that's called the African Reservation, which is where the people of color in Bedford, between the founding in 1729 and the time that this burying ground was closed in 1849, is where the people of color were buried. There's a rock there that says Cambridge Moore, Caesar Prescott, Caesar Jones, Negro slaves, soldiers in the Revolution, 1775 to 1782. And for a long time, I thought, well, these are the only three people of color who ever lived in Bedford. They're the only three that have a memorial. But being a town historian, I figured I better have the backstory on that. And I looked through town records and town, just everything I could get my hands on, and I found that, oh, you did it, that there are probably at least 20 names of people who were held, most of them as slaves, in Bedford. I feel like when I say their names, I wake them from their sleep. Abraham, Ishmael, Pomp, Violet, Nanny. There's so little personal information about them, it was hard just to find their names. And I apologize not being able to tell you a story about each one of them. Now, the slave owners are much easier to find. These are the people in Bedford that you've heard of, Joe Blaine and people that you've heard of. They tend to be the wealthy people in town. They tend to be the people of importance, like your minister, your selectmen, your landowners, your deacons, your military officers. They have the money to have a slave, but the slave does the work for them, so they have more time to make more money. This is a Job Lane house. I learned first about the Job Lane family. Major John Lane, who was our Job Lane's father, the Job Lane that we know built this house. There are lots of Job Lanes in town. But his father had at least two slaves, and his two brothers had one as well. And we know this because at the Historical Society, in the Lane papers, we have the receipt for the purchase of a slave. You're not going to be able to read this. The only person who could read this was Lee Yates, who's the one who transcribed it, right? And when you transcribed it, you found out that it said, "Know all men that I, Nate Tay of Billerica, in the county of Middlesex, in New England, have sold and delivered my Negro servant Tony under Mr. John Lane of ye same place, for and in consideration whereof I said Tay have received and said paid £20 in money and £6 by bill, which is in full for said Negro, as witness my hand this 22nd of April, 1691. It was quite legal to have slaves in early Bedford. As a matter of fact, it was not Virginia or Georgia, but Massachusetts that was the first of the 13 colonies to make slavery legal. They didn't just let it happen, they made it legal. It's called the Body of Liberties. Can you hear me when I talk sideways? It is ordered by this court and the authorities thereof, this comes out of the Massachusetts General Court, that there shall never be any bond, slavery, villainage, or captivity amongst us unless it be lawful captives taken in just wars, now that's Native Americans, and such strangers as willingly sell themselves or our soul to us. So that would be all right. I've discovered that between 1644 and 1780, 23 slave ships docked in Boston. They didn't ever, I believe, come from Africa to Boston. They would go from Africa to Barbados, where they'd pick up sugar and tobacco and slaves. They'd go from there to Boston, where they would bring rum. Did you know that there were 66 distilleries, rum distilleries in Massachusetts back in those days? We were really good at making rum. Maybe fish and lumber would be sent back to Barbados, and money to acquire slaves would be sent to Africa. This is the slavery triangle. Talking about the Job Lane family, Job of the eponymous museum, don't you love to say eponymous? Did not seem to own a slave. He had an indentured servant that he was teaching farming to. And you know Nathaniel Page, who was the colonial soldier who carried the Bedford flag. His father's father's father is the one who first moved to Billerica. And at his death in 1692, he willed to his wife his slave, unnamed, worth £15. Now, you can't tell if it doesn't say a Negro, a person of color, a black person, a slave, if it was actually a slave. It could have been an indentured servant, or it could have been a servant. Worth £15 makes you wonder, doesn't it? That it was someone that was owned. This person, because Mrs. Page, Joanna Page, was widowed, she never married again, and she had small children. Her oldest was about 13. I think it was the help of this man who allowed her to keep the farm and grow and prosper. So Yeah. This is the old meeting house, the Bedford meeting house. A.E. Brown drew this sketch. And it's, you see it a lot because it's the only really sketch we have. And if you visited the church about 1750, you would notice that the people of color would be sitting in the balcony of the church because that's where their assigned pews were. And the slaves would include Nanny, who was the slave of the minister. The minister's slave was included in his will. He willed to his wife, Lucy, his slave not as a beneficiary, but to be passed on to Lucy as an item of ownership. She remarried and moved to Arlington. We wonder if her family, Nanny's family was split up when this happened. We wonder if there was a husband maybe that she had to leave behind. I can't find anything more about Nanny, so that'll have to wait till the next lecture. One of the most important documents in the Bedford Historical Society archives is this one. And I just brought it so you'd be impressed with how hard it is to decode them. But you can switch it. Know all men by these presents that I, Joseph Fitch of Bedford, in consideration of the sum of 24 pounds lawful money, do bargain and sell unto the said Joseph Hartwell, a Negro boy about 5 years old, called Jeffrey. Signed, sealed, and delivered, Joseph Fitch. Now, Jeffrey lived with the Hartwells, we presume, until the time of the Revolution. It was common for people to send their slave into warfare, into the military, instead of doing it yourself. And I believe Jeffrey was sent, I know he was sent to Bunker Hill, survived, came home, and was paid for his service, and his owner, Hartwell, took his pay and put it in his pocket. And this outraged Jeffrey, who somehow managed to get himself re-enlisted for 4 terms. And when he finally got out of the Continental Army, he didn't come home to Bedford. He came to Draycott. There was quite a black community in Draycott. Actually, it was called Black North, the little town. And he was buried there, so he's not one of the people on the stone in the historical, in the burying ground. Linda. Yes. Linda said she is the one who wrote the letter to say, you've got a new street here, let's call it, did you say call it Caesar Jones Way?
I just said name it after one of the slaves. I just also thought that there was only 3 buried there as well.
Name after one of the slaves, and so they did. Caesar Jones Way.
I was hoping they'd do all three, but I'll settle for one.
Oh, she was hoping they'd do all three, but she'd settle for one. Okay. Let's talk about these three soldiers that we know about. You know Abram English Brown, who's just the Bible on Bedford, and he's my hero. He says that before 1780, slaves were sent into the army to the credit of their masters, which means they got to keep the money. Cambridge Moore provided a Negro. Caesar Prescott was hired, actually. And Caesar Jones, Cambridge Moore, there's very little, even though we do know about these. Caesar Prescott seems to have been from Concord and moved to Bedford and married a woman named Jane Clark. He was, I think, a free man when he came, and he was given or paid 20 head of cattle to enlist in the army. So now, not just being sent by an owner, but actually recruited and paid for being in the army. Cambridge Moore also. And a couple years later, there's a receipt from Caesar Jones for a bounty of 60 pounds for 33 years for the town of Bedford. You know, they specified for each town how many soldiers you had to provide. And then the town would scuffle among itself to say, okay, who's gonna go, who's gonna do it? Okay. In 1780, that was the year of the Massachusetts Constitution. And people in Bedford would soon be free if they weren't already. I think this was a trickle-down thing. It wasn't really, you've got this constitution and it says you've got to free the slaves. It's not an emancipation proclamation. Can you read it? You want me to read it to you? Read it. All men are born free and equal and have certain natural, essential, and unalienable rights, among which may be reckoned the right of enjoying and defending their lives and liberties, that of acquiring, possessing, and protecting property, in fine, that of seeking and obtaining their safety and happiness. Now, there was a woman, not a Bedford woman, out in western Massachusetts named Elizabeth Freeman, they call her Bet, who took her master to court to say, this says I can be free. And they battled it about in court and decided in her favor. Yes, she was free. So then a man, I believe Worcester, Quack Walker, was beaten by his owner, took his owner to court and said, you do not own me and you can't beat me. And that was decided as well. There was never a Massachusetts state declaration that there'd be no more slavery. That's kind of how it trickled into the law. I almost said steering wheel. This isn't a steering wheel. A spinning wheel in because of one of the people who had been enslaved was Violet. I don't know her last name. And she was owned by John Moore, who was the captain of the militia on April 19, 1775. He had several slaves, and Violet was one. And at his death in 1807, he made provision for Violet in his will and said to his children, take care of Violet as long as she lives. Well, Violet lived to be 100 years old. And her children said, no, we're not taking care of her all this long. So she died penniless, a pauper. They had to buy the dress to bury her in because she didn't have anything decent to wear. Now, this is kind of a second half. Take a breath here. You know this song, follow the drinking gourd. Follow the drinking gourd, and the old man's a-waiting for to carry you to freedom. Follow the drinking gourd. Well, in Bedford, the people before the Civil War, desperately trying to escape, were they coming through Bedford? Here's Lewis Hayden. Lewis Hayden lived in Boston on the back side of Beacon Hill, which was a black neighborhood. He'd been a slave himself, had escaped to the north, made his fortune, owned a clothing store and a house. And when people came looking for safety, they would put him in touch with Lewis Hayden, and Lewis Hayden would keep the escaping slave in his attic would give him or her new clothing, and sometimes would give him or her a ride in his carriage out to the next station house on the Underground Railroad. Now this is all I could find. This is a map made by a fellow named Wilbur Siebert about 1935. Now how he knew in 1935 what was going on in 1840, 1850, we wonder. And you probably won't be able to see, but if you can, there's a trail from Boston out through Concord and up north. And there's a trail from Boston up through Medford and up north. And there's nothing in that little space between Medford and Concord, that Woburn, that should have Bedford in it. And I don't believe this map at all. I think, well, you know the Middlesex Turnpike? The Middlesex Turnpike was a big deal. That was the main road between Nashua, New Hampshire, and Boston. And the Teamsters would come down with their wagons and right through Bedford. Actually, you know the Middlesex Turnpike doesn't go except in a corner, but a lot of the Teamsters didn't want to pay the fine, so they kind of came off, pay the toll. So they kind of came off and came through the main part of Bedford. Where's Bill Moonen? I called up Bill the other day to say, Bill, do you know that the fence around the common was put up because those Teamsters made the common so muddy with their horses? Bill said, I don't know, but you said I could say it anyway, right? Yeah. There were many routes, and they were not random. If you'd used a station house before, you would use it again. People would have a network of family, good friends, business associates, and people who were in the anti-slavery societies to have a station at their house. And you probably wouldn't know the whole route. You would know the station before you and the station after you. And that's all you'd know. Of course, the person who was escaping know the whole way. There's a difference between anti-slavery and abolition. Anti-slavery is being against slavery. This is a bad thing, it's a philosophy. We should end slavery. It's a bad thing. It's a philosophy. Abolitionism is a movement. We need to end slavery now. We need to have an underground railroad that can save slaves. If we need to break the law, we'll break the law. John Brown was an abolitionist. So, in Bedford, it was more, when do I say this? Yeah, I say it right now. In Bedford, there was more of an anti-slavery feeling than there was an abolition feeling. And part of why I know this is from an entry in Frederick Douglass's journal. Will you? Oh, he's so good. Did you meet my husband? This is my husband, Tom. He's good. Harriet Tubman, too, came through this area. They were in Concord on a lecture tour trying to raise money for the Underground Railroad, and people, when they arrived in Canada, their welfare, because there was nothing for them when they got to Canada. Frederick Douglass was actually talking about a meeting that he had in Sudbury, but there's a little aside on Bedford, and I want you to hear it. Our meeting, or contemplated meeting at Sudbury, was a total failure. We had no meeting. The clergy here, as in Bedford, arraigned themselves against us, misrepresenting our views, maligning our characters, and arraying against us the mob spirit of the places. So Bedford had a mob spirit against abolitionism? I don't know. I don't know. I couldn't find anything more, just that little bit. But very soon, there was up at the Frederick Douglass is 1842 that he came to Bedford. This is the Great Massachusetts Petition that was made just about at the same time. So many towns in Massachusetts received this petition and signed it that said, we must forever separate the people of Massachusetts from all connection with slavery. And in Bedford, 123 people signed it. Now, the population of Bedford was only 1,000, and there were 180 heads of households. So 123 out of 1,000, I think, is pretty good, and it shows a moving forward in the cause, would you say? There are wonderful books, two wonderful books called Black Walden, and the other one I can't remember right now, I'll tell you in a minute. And they talk about what was happening in Concord and kind of extrapolate that, what was happening in Bedford, although Concord was a hotbed of anti-slavery and abolitionism. In Concord, the female anti-slavery society would have teas and picnics to raise money, and they also sewed underwear for the escaping slaves. They were very active. They were doing their bit. And they also, the book mentioned an anti-man hunting league. The anti-man hunting league were lots of groups all around, but mostly centered in Concord, in Austin. After the fugitive slave law was passed, which said that, sure, anybody who's lost a slave can come up to Massachusetts and get him and take him back home or her, and that slave can't speak for themselves in court. If you help that slave, you will be prosecuted as well. So the Anti-Man Hunting League would practice this activity, this practice, this thing. They would each take a number, and the large circle outside has people standing at each number. And then on the inside, there's a C. I don't know why it's a C. It's for the guy's head. AA for two arms, FF for 2 feet, and S for the speaker. And they would grab the guy by head, arms, and feet and hold him and surround him with other people in the anti-manhunting league. And the speaker would entreat with the slave hunter, stop, go home, don't do this. And if he couldn't be persuaded, they would drag him off and hide him somewhere until he changed his mind. Alas, or perhaps good, this club never was called upon to do it. They had all these rehearsals. They had everything in place. Everybody knew their number. It was a secret club. They had passwords. They had handshakes. It was very secret, and I really wanted to know if anybody in Bedford was in the anti-manhunting league. So this is where my librarianship comes in. Somehow, I found that the Mass Historical Society in Boston had some papers about the anti-man-hating hunting society. So I went in, and they brought, have you ever been in there? You go and you sit at the table. You can't have your pocketbook. You can't have anything. And you tell the librarian what you want, and she brings it to you and puts it on the desk. You can only have one thing at a time. So when you're done, you go up to the librarian and say, I'm done, and then go back and sit down. And then she will come and take the paper back and then bring you the next paper, because that stuff is so valuable. Well, I found a lot of papers about the Anti-Manhunting Society. all kinds of towns in Middlesex County. Nothing under Bedford. Looked and looked and looked, page through, page through, page through. And at the very end, it said miscellaneous. And I thought, there's nothing in the main pages. There's not going to be anything in miscellaneous. And there, in miscellaneous, Reuben Bacon of Bedford is a member of the Anti-Man Hunting Society. I always want to say man-hating society. Which I think it's probably true. Probably true. So this is Charles Sumner. Do you remember this story? He was the senator from Massachusetts. He was down in Washington giving a flaming speech against slavery. And the representative from South Carolina, a couple of days later, found him on the Senate floor and beat him with his cane so severely that he was badly injured. Well, Bedford was enraged. And they called a town meeting, and town meeting appointed three men to compose a resolution. And it said, "With grief and indignation, the people of Bedford resolve to bring back our government to the principles upon which it was founded. Failing this, we recommend that Massachusetts withdraw its delegation from Congress and with her sister states form a more perfect union based upon the principles embodied in the Declaration of Independence." So, Bedford, this is not something that came from other places in Massachusetts. This is the Bedford resolution, and it passed in town meeting. Bedford taking a stand. So it's moving forward from where they started. Well, you came here to find out the real juice, didn't you? You want to know whose house? Whose house? Okay, Tom, show them whose house. See this secret stairway? There's kind of a bottom stair that you can move out of the way, and then you put it there and open the little cupboard door, and there's an incredibly steep stairway that goes up into the darkness. Now, whose house? Where is she? Whose house is this? Well, she's right here. She doesn't wanna admit it. It's Kay Spofford's house. And Kay will tell you that there is no evidence. Say it. What do you always say to me when I say, give me a picture of that? I've never heard any specific history about it.
But I've seen, through the years, so many different, maybe church, Sunday school teachers bring their group down.
She's saying that she's seen Sunday school teachers bring their group down the street. She suggested this afternoon, actually, that we take this meeting down. She just lives down the street and up into the back hallway and through and to see her secret stairway. Mary Hafer, I didn't see today. Mary Hafer's house has a space between the wall and the chimney. The Fitch Tavern has a strange kind of brickwork in the architectural design of the basement, maybe holding up the chimney, maybe the entrance to a tunnel that goes under the road to the old barn. But there's no evidence. Nobody's written in their diaries. Nobody's actually passed the story down. Give me the, oh, it didn't show up. This is a lantern. A.E. Brown is my dependable voice, and A.E. Brown was born in 1849 in the house at the, you know, the four-way stop by Springs Road and Page Road and Pine Hill Road. That house that the stone wall is out into the road and you're always afraid you're going to hit it when you go by, that's the house that A.E. Brown lived in. And right now it's Will Knox and Margaret Fleischman's house and Will Knox. And that is supposed to have, Margaret showed me on the landing of the stairway, a trap door. And she said, people say, maybe this is it. But A.E. Brown was a historian. He was born in this house. And there's nothing in any of the books that he's written about his house being a stop on the Underground Railway. So what I have to tell you is that I don't know. I know it was secret, and maybe nobody told because it was secret, but afterwards, after the Civil War, it was such a measure of honor to have been a house on the Underground Railroad. You'd think that more proof than this would come down. So I'm to tell you, they may have come through on the Middlesex Turnpike. You can see the wagoners, the teamsters with their wagon with a cloth over the back, riding up north, just exactly what you'd want going through Concord, Bedford. And there was a wonderful hotel right at the corner where the fire station is now, which was the Bedford Hotel. And stagecoaches and teams would stop there for a little, you know, and change horses. Yeah, but I have to say that Bedford was not the poster child of the Underground Railroad. And there'll be no historic sign erected in front of a house. But the story of the Underground Railway is more than the address of a house. And I think Bedford's story is very typical of small towns in Massachusetts. And it's a story worth retelling and worth knowing to dismiss the myths that we grew up with, that there were no slaves in Bedford, or maybe there were three, but they were freed, you know, quickly. That it wasn't as bad as it was in the South. And, it's not on us. Slavery, it's not on us. It's on us. We need to make sure that the stories of those who were buried in the African reservation do not molder and disappear. And that's mine.
Anybody have any questions for Sharon?
Yeah, I was interested in the early comments that the slave would be given a firearm and volunteered by design into the army. Isn't it in those days quite dangerous to give a slave a firearm?
I think that's true. In the South, it would be unheard of. In the North, I don't know. I just assumed that if you were going to the North Bridge on April 19th, you'd have a weapon. If you were a soldier in the Continental Army, you'd have a weapon. But I hadn't thought of that. I don't know. What do you think?
The Army needs more than people to carry guns. They need people to do other things, too.
Mm-hmm. They need people to do other things. That can well be. I hadn't thought of that. Yes?
Do you think that the slaves in the North were treated better than on the Southern plantations?
Were the slaves in the North treated better than those on the Southern plantations? When I'm looking for an image to put into my slideshow, if I put in slaves or slavery, I find people with their backs torn by whips and wearing those necklaces and being just
mistreated.
Thank you, Tom. I don't think it was that bad in the North, which is to say families were split up. People were forced to stand on the block and be bid upon and sold back and forth, which is bad, but I think not being as bad as... Also in the North, it was a smaller number of slaves in your ownership. You might have one or two or three. I think at the Isaac Royal House and Slave Place, they had 12. But it's not these huge plantations where people are so anonymous.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say, without plantations, I mean, you didn't have the same kind of, you know, abuse that you had of the workers there. I mean, I think probably it was closer, you know, to what were considered the house slaves.
He's saying not in the even in the plantations, more like the house slaves would be what we were doing in the north. Yes.
Well, also, the numbers in the South, they had the white family owners of the plantation and so forth, and they had many more numerically black people in bondage. And so they had to use fear. They used fear and greater brutality just simply to, because they themselves felt that if one slave got out of hand, they couldn't handle 100 of them getting out of hand.
Mm-hmm. Can you hear him? He's saying that in, you heard him?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Good point.
I've been reading a book that was written by a speaker at the Lyceum at First Parish a while ago, a founding martyr about Joseph Warren, who's killed at Bunker Hill. And I'm in the middle of that where they talk about the British just mercilessly beating hundreds of strokes on the back of the people until they were totally unconscious and almost dead. If they're doing that to their own troops, I would not like to have been a black man working for them.
Mm-hmm. Somebody over here? Sharon? Tom.
Sharon, perhaps the most important contribution of Massachusetts to the slave economy was the fact of refining all that cotton from the South into the cloth that really provided the economic engine for the whole system.
Right, he's saying that in Massachusetts, it was very important to use that cotton that was being produced in the South to make cloth here in the North. Yeah? Did I say it right?
Yeah.
Lois. Lois. It does.
I'm reading a biography right now of George Washington between the time he left the service of the country, the end of the Revolutionary War, and the Continental Congress. So it's a period of about 8 years, something like that. And at that time, he had 316 slaves, and he had been telling family members that he was never going to acquire any more, and that he thought it wasn't a good idea. But unfortunately, he did keep getting them. However, he said, well, either I'll will them to my wife or children, or I will say in the will that they should be free when I die. But I haven't finished the book, and I don't know if it will refer to it again. I just kept wondering.
Should I bring it back? I think it's a good idea, though. Counting slaves in the George Washington case is a little like counting apples and oranges, in that slightly over half of them were not his. They were the life estate of his wife, and therefore he could not set them free. And they had intermarried and become intermingled in a family sort of way with his own. The state of Virginia did not recognize the right of slaves to marry. So he was caught in an impossible situation. He can't free them, because the only way he could do that would be to buy them from the estate, which he could not afford to do.
I mean, it's not a matter of defending the fact that he was involved in this. It's just that in the context of the times, he's in a box that he had no way to get out of. And I, even though he was opposed to slavery. So I think it's a little misleading to just count numbers and say, well, he didn't free them. He felt that he could not do so. Just a comment.
Sharon, in your research, since everyone knows that Bedford was quite a, had developed quite an industry in the cord weaving, the shoemaking, did you identify or determine whether any of the people of color worked in that industry along with their owners?
In the census records, they would tick a box that said if you were white or Negro. And I don't remember finding any in 1840. Before that, it's kind of hard to find census records. In the 1850s and the 1860s, there was one black family in Bedford, the Gant family, and they were farmers. So I haven't found anything in the cord weaving business, but maybe. Okay? Thank you so much.